Hello students, welcome back. Today we are going to discuss some more competitive bits from evolution exercise level 2. Question number 1. Which one of the pairs does not depict placental and marsupial mammals respectively having similar ways of life? Options 1. Lemur and spotted cuscus. 2. Wombat and coil bear. 3. Flying squirrel and flying phalanger. 4. Anteater and numbat. So let's see. Lemur, flying squirrel, anteater. All three are placental mammals and show convergent evolution. Spotted cuscus, flying phalangers, numbat. They are placental marsupials showing convergent evolution. Based on this information, lemur is a placental mammal and spotted cuscus is a placental marsupial, but both are showing the convergent evolution. And next, flying squirrel is a placental mammal and flying phalanger is a placental marsupials. Both are showing convergent evolution. And another one, anteater, it is a placental mammals. Numbat, it is a placental marsupials showing convergent evolution. So in the options 1, 3 and 4, one animal is a placental mammal and a second animal is a placental marsupials and both are showing convergent evolution. So here the question is having similar way of life, that is wombat and coil bear, both are belongs to marsupials of Australia. That means the having similar way of life, marsupials of Australia, wombat and coil bear. So they both are showing divergent evolution, wombat and coil bear, and both are marsupials of Australia. Whereas in the remaining option, one is a marsupial placental and another one is the placental mammal. So the correct answer is option 2. Question number 2. The biogenetic law of Haeckel is options 1. Omnis vivum e vivum. 2. Omnis cellula e cellula. 3. Ontogeny repeats phylogeny. 4. Phylogeny repeats ontogeny. Let's see about Haeckel. The biogenetic law is proposed by Haeckel. As per this law, it states that ontogeny repeats or recapitulates phylogeny. That is, the development of an organism, that is ontogeny, expresses all the intermediate form of its ancestors through evolution, phylogeny. So the biogenetic law states that ontogeny repeats phylogeny. This biogenetic law is also called theory of recapitulation. So the correct answer is option 3. Question number 3. Theory of natural selection dwells on options 1. Role of environment in evolution. 2. Natural selection acting on favorable variations. 3. Changes in gene complex resulting in heritable variations. 4. Inheritance of acquired characters. Let's see. According to Darwin's theory of evolution, more individuals are produced in each generation that can survive. Only the organisms best adapted to their environment tend to survive and transmit their genetic characters in increasing numbers to succeeding generations, while those less adapted to be eliminated. So these statements indicates that Darwin proposed a theory, that is Darwin's theory. He proposed that natural selection. So this natural selection always acting on favorable variations. That favorable variations are increased in number to succeeding generations. Those who are not selected by nature, they are eliminated. So the correct answer is option 2, natural selection acting on favorable variation. And here the fourth option, inheritance of acquired characters, it is proposed by Jean Lamarck. Question number 4, name the law that states embryonic development of an animal repeats the embryonic stages of ancestors. Options 1, biogenetic law, 2, Anaximander's law, 3, Flocken's law, 4, law of segregation. Among these options, as per our syllabus, Anaximander's law and Flocken's law, we cannot aware of that. So let's see law of segregation. So it states during gamete formation, the two alleles at a gene locus segregate from each other. Biogenetic law, it is already we discussed in question number 2. So it states that ontogeny recapsulates phylogeny, that is the development of an organism expresses all the intermediate forms of its ancestors through evolution. So as per question, the correct answer is biogenetic law or theory of recapsulation. So Anaximander's law, this Anaximander has been called as the father of astronomy. Question number 5, major defect of Darwin's theory was options 1, non-description of survival of fittest, 2, non-description of inheritance of fittest, 3, non-description of overproduction of young ones, 4, non-description of reason for variation. So let's see Darwinism or Darwin's theory. So Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection was universally accepted by biologists, that is natural selection. Now, the main drawbacks of this Darwin's theory, it failed to explain the basis of variation, and also it failed to explain the mode of transmission of variations to the next generation. So as per these drawbacks, the correct answer is non-description of reason for variation. That is the correct option. Fourth is the correct option. Question number 6, which one does not favor Lamarckian concept of inheritance of acquired characters? Options 1, lack of pigment in cave dwellers, 2, absence of limbs in snakes, 3, presence of webbed toes in aquatic birds, 4, melanization of peppered moth in industrial areas. So let's see, melanization of peppered moth in industrial areas is an effect of natural selection, where due to change in environmental condition of the two moths form that existed, the light and black, the black was favored by natural selection over the light, as the light were easily spotted by its predator due to the industrialization. So which one does not favors the Lamarckian concept, that is inheritance of acquired character? melanization of peppered moth in industrial area. It does not favor the Lamarckian concept. So the correct answer is option 4. Question number 7. Beside radio dating, which method can be used to find out whether a fossil is of an older era? Options 1. Lava deposits. 2. Igneous rocks. 3. Metamorphic rocks. 4. Sedimentary strata. So let's know about that. Lava deposits form molten rock by geothermal energy. Igneous rocks are also called as magmatic rocks, formed through the cooling and solidification of lava. Metamorphic rocks arise from the transformation of existing rock. Sedimentary strata. Strata are layers of rock. These layers, that means strata, are laid down as sediment, often in the sea, and are closely changed, and are slowly changed by pressure, heat, and chemical action into rocks. So the question is, beside radio dating, which method can be used to find out whether a fossil is of an older era? So that it becomes old when it is a sedimentary. So sedimentary process, it takes a long period, slow, and changed by pressure, heat, and chemical action into the rocks. It is a long process. So that's why sedimentary strata, the fossil of a older era. So the correct option is option 4. Question number 8. Which one is considered the first biological catalyst when life originate on Earth? Options 1. RNA. 2. DNA. 3. Protein. 4. Lipid. So let's see. We are all well known that Urey and Miller, Stanley Miller, conducted an experiment on theory of chemical evolution, which is proposed by Oparin and Haldane. So these two scientists, they are created the early Earth's atmospheric condition. Early atmospheric condition is reduced, means it doesn't have oxygen and it consists of methane, ammonia, hydrogen, water vapor, gases only in the atmosphere. So they observed the formation of amino acids in their experiment. So that indicates these amino acids are carried by RNA to ribosomes and synthesize them into a proteins. So that's why the first biological catalyst when life is originated on Earth is RNA, because this RNA carries that amino acid, acts as a catalyst to carry the amino acid to the ribosomes to synthesize the proteins. So hence, the correct answer is option 1, RNA. Question number 9. Match the following. So column 1. A. Saltation. B. Formation of life was preceded by chemical evolution. C. Reproductive fitness. D. Life comes from pre-existing life. Column 2. 1. Darwin. 2. Louis Pasteur. 3. De Vries. 4. Oparin and Haldane. So A. Saltation, it is proposed by De Vries, that is column 3. Column 2, 3 option, that is De Vries. So he proposed the mutation theory. So single step large mutation, that is saltation, we will call it as. So saltation degrees, A is 3. B, formation of life was preceded by chemical evolution. So the chemical evolution is proposed by Oparin and Alden. So B is 4. C, reproductive fitness. So reproductive fitness, it is explained by Darwin in natural selection. So C is 1, Darwin. D, life comes from pre-existing life. So it is proposed by Louis Pasteur. He disproved that abiogenesis theory, spontaneous generation of life. It is disproved or disapproved by Louis Pasteur. So as per this information, the correct answer, A is 3, B is 4, C is 1, D, C is 1, D is 2. So the correct answer is option 1, A is 3, B is 4, C is 1, D is 2. Question number 10, which of the following ancestors probably did not eat meat? Options 1, Ramapithecus, 2, Australopithecus, 3, Homo habilis, 4, all of the above. So as for information, Ramapithecus eat seeds and nuts and they are man-like apes. Australopithecus, they are omnivorous, but means they are depending on both flesh or meat or on the plant products, and they did not have chin. And Homo habilis did not eat meat, and we can observe a major increase in size of the cranium. So cranial capacity when compared to the Ramapithecus, Australopithecus, Homo habilis having more. So as per this information, which of the following ancestors probably did not eat meat? That is Homo habilis, option 3. Question number 11. The earliest fossil form in phylogeny of horse is? Options 1, Merychippus, 2, Mesohippus, 3, Eohippus, 4, Equus. So for this we need to study about period and name of the fossils we can observe during evolution of horse. So period and name of the fossil. So first, that is a Pleistocene, that is advanced, well developed, equals the present day horse, modern day horse. So Pleistocene equals, and before that Pleistocene, the period is Pliocene. In that period, the name of the fossil is the Pliohippus, Miocene. So in that period, Merychippus is the fossil name of the horse. Oligocene, in that, during that period, the name of the fossil of horse is Miohippus. And early Oligocene, the name of the fossil of horse is Mesohippus. And Eocene, the name of the fossil of horse is Eohippus. So in this period and name of the fossil horses, the earliest form in the phylogeny of horse is earliest. So earliest means starting, that is Eocene period is the earliest in the evolution of horse. That earliest form of horse is Eohippus. And modern form is the Equus. So this is the pattern of the evolution. So the period, earliest period is Eocene, and recent period, that is a modern form of horse, is evolved in the Pleistocene period. So intermediate forms of this, the modern as well as earliest, or these forms or the intermediate forms between modern and earliest form in the phylogeny of horse. So the earliest form is Eohippus and modern form is Equus. And Merychippus and Mesochippus are the intermediate forms in the evolution of horse from Eohippus to Equus. So the correct answer is Eohippus is the earliest form in the phylogeny of horse. The correct answer is option 3. Question number 12. Neanderthal man lived in options 1. Desert, 2. Deep forest, 3. Mountains, 4. Caves. Let's know information about Neanderthal man. So Neanderthal man brain capacity is 1400 cubic centimeter. So diet, he ate omnivorous. He is omnivorous. He ate meat as well as plant products. And significance is he is a cave dweller. That means he used to live in caves. And he used the hides as a cloth to cover the body and buried the dead. So dead bodies, they are started to buried under the ground. So as for this information, Neanderthal man lived in caves. So the correct answer is option 4. Question number 13. Mesozoic era is known as golden age of options 1. Fishes, 2. Amphibians, 3. Reptiles, 4. Mollusks. So among this information, mollusks, we did not have any information about the golden age. So now let's see that the golden age of fishes is the Devonian period. Golden age of amphibians is Carboniferous period. Golden age of reptiles is Mesozoic era. So Mesozoic era is known as golden age of reptiles. So option 3 is correct. Question number 14. Which is incorrect statement given below? Options 1. Wings of insects and bat are homologous. Wings of insects and bats are analogous. Wings of bats and birds are homologous. 4. Wings of insects and birds are analogous. These are the 4 statements are given. So we are all well known and already are written in your notebooks. Wings of birds and wings of bat are homologous is the correct. So wings of bat and wings of birds are homologous. This statement is correct. Now, wings of insects and wings of birds are analogous. Wings of insects and wings of birds are analogous. Once remember it, birds' wings are homologous to the bat's wings. So now once apply this statement, wings of insects are analogous to the wings of birds. That means the wings of insects are also analogous to the wings of bats. So that means second statement is also correct. Wings of insects and wings of bats are analogous, not homologous. So the incorrect statement is option 1. Question number 15. Birbal Sahni worked on options 1. Algae, 2. Fossil plants, 3. Angiosperms, 4. Bryophytes. Let's see. Birbal Sahni was an Indian paleobotanist, botany study of plants, paleology study of fossils. That means it indicates that Birbal Sahni, he studied the fossil plants of the Indian subcontinent. So hence the correct answer is he worked, Birbal Sahani worked on fossil plants. Option 2 is the correct answer. Question number 16. Cranial capacity of Australopithecus was. So let's know the options. 1. 390 to 510 cubic centimeters. Second option. 675 to 719 cubic centimeters. Option 3. 1015 to 1075 cubic centimeters. 4. 882 to 897 cubic centimeters. So in this option, first let's know the value of these cranial capacities belongs to which organism. So let's see. 882 to 897 cubic centimeters. That is the cranial capacity of Homo erectus. And 675 to 719 cubic centimeters is the cranial capacity of Homo habilis. 390 to 510 cubic centimeters is the cranial capacity of Australopithecus. And here option 3, it is not information to any of the organism belongs to this human evolution. It is not mentioned anywhere. So we know 1400 cubic centimeters Neanderthal man. So that's why the correct answer for this cranial capacity of Australopithecus is 390 to 510 cubic centimeters. This is correct answer. 675 to 719 cubic centimeters is the Homo habilis. And 880 to 897 cubic centimeters is the Homo erectus cranial capacity. So for this question, correct answer is option 1. Question number 17. Modern man differs from apes in options 1. Protruding eyes. 2. Sparse body hair. 3. Arms shorter than legs. 4. Wearing of cloth. So let's see. The modern man differ from the apes in arms shorter than legs. In apes, the arms help in the locomotion called tracheation. It is a type of suspension and swinging of the body. So here in this question, wearing of cloth is not at all considered the difference between modern man and the apes. So the major difference is in apes, the arms are also used in locomotion, whereas in man, we are using only legs are using for the locomotion, whereas in apes, arms are also used for the locomotion. So in that concept, in human, arms are shorter than legs because we are not using for the locomotion. So the correct answer is option 3. Question number 18. Role of embryonic development was given by options 1. Bear. 2. Haeckel. 3. Mendel. 4. Darwin. Let's see the information about these scientists. Haeckel, he proposed the biogenetic law or law of recapitulation or theory of recapitulation. Mendel is the father of genetics, and Darwin proposed origin of species, and he is the father of evolution. And von Baer, he discovered the mammalian ovum, and made significant contributions to the study of the embryonic development of animals. So the question is, a rule of embryonic development was given by Von Baer. So the correct answer is option 1. Question number 19. Archaeopteryx is known as missing or connecting link because it is a fossil and has a characteristic between options 1. Fishes and amphibians, 2. Birds and reptiles, 3. Reptiles and mammals, 4. Chordates and non-chordates. So let's know about Archaeopteryx. Archaeopteryx was discovered by Wagner and it is a missing link and it is a connecting link between birds and reptiles. So the correct answer is option 2. So Archaeopteryx having feathers and wings like a bird's and having scales on their body, that is the reptilian character. So the correct answer is option 2. Question number 20. Presence of tail and corus hair in human baby is, so means sudden appearance of the tail or maybe corus body hair in the human baby is options 1. Radiation, 2. Atavism, 3. Mutation, 4. Crossing over. So mutation means sudden change in the genetic material. 4. Crossing over, that means recombination of the chromosome, crossing of chromatids of the chromosome. So what is this atavism? So atavism is the phenomena in which phenotypic trait, that means character, appear in an organism after a period of absence. The sudden appearance of that ancestor characters is called as the atavism. So presence of tail and body hair in a human baby is a phenomenon of appearance of the phenotypic characters of their ancestor, sudden appearance. So that's why the correct answer is atavism. Option 2 is correct. Question number 21. Closely related species with different triads exhibit options 1. Convergent evolution, 2. Divergent evolution, 3. Parallel evolution, 4. None of the above. Let's know about this convergent and divergent evolutions. Convergent evolution, the independent evolution of similar features in species of different periods in time. Convergent evolution creates analogous structures that have similar form or function but were not present in the last common ancestor of those groups. Divergent evolution, the process where by groups from the same common ancestor evolve and accumulate differences resulting in the formation of new species. Hence, closely related species with different triads exhibit divergent evolution. So the correct option is, the closely related species with the different triads exhibit divergent evolution. Option 2 is correct. Question number 22. Common origin of man and chimpanzee is best shown by options 1. Cranial capacity, 2. Binocular vision, 3. Chromosome, 4. Dental formula. So this question already we discussed in the first part, 14th question. So let's see. Fossil evidences suggest that the chimpanzee is more closely related to human because the following steps. Genetic makeup. 90% of genetic material matched to the chimpanzee. And another one closely related to the chimpanzee because of chromosomal morphology. The banding pattern of individual chromosomes is much similar to the banding pattern in the chromosome of chimpanzee. So the correct answer is option 3, chromosome. Question number 23. Java ape man was discovered by options. Du Bois 2. Leakey 3. Cuvier 4. Black. So let's know about this Java ape man. Java man or Java ape man, extinct hominid known from fossil remains found on the island of Java, Indonesia. This Java ape man discovered by the Dutch anatomist and geologist Eugenie Du Bois in 1891, where the first known fossil of the species Homo erectus, so that Java ape man scientifically called as Homo erectus. So the correct answer, the Java ape man was discovered by Du Bois in 1891 in Java, Indonesia. Option 1 is correct. Thank you, students. We will discuss remaining bits from level 2 in the next part.